4 on submissions work. Les and Holly Pitts, amen, they're going to be here. Most folks remember Les, Pastor Wendell Pruitt, and several other in his wonderful, lovely family will be here to help minister. The rest of the team will be here on Tuesday, about 23, coming from Virginia, if you guys have heard, will be here on Tuesday. So if 4 or 4:30, if we can be here and be ready in preparation to receive them guys at 5 o'clock, that would be absolutely wonderful. Turn with me to St. John chapter 4. Very familiar scripture, but there's one verse in here, and I don't know that I'll be before you, but just a very short amount of time. I just want to pull out a couple little tidbits out of here. We're going to start in the meat of this text about verse 3. It's talking about Jesus when it says he left Judea and departed again unto Galilee. Verse 4 says, and he must needs go through Samaria. Now that alone right there tells a little bit something about the text in this scripture, because Jesus obviously was a person of Jewish heritage. He was a Jew. And where was he getting ready to travel through? Bible says Samaria. And we know that there was some conflict and some issues with some, we would call today, some bigotry and some racism, where Jesus going through a part of town and going in an area where he probably would not have been received very well. And verse 5 says, then he cometh to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near the parcel of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. And this is what I want to point out in this right here, verse 6. Now Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being wearied with his journey. Does that strike anybody odd in here at all, that Jesus would get tired? Sat thus on the well, and it was about the sixth hour. We see here the Son of God, God incarnated in the flesh, sent to this earth, the one who created the universe, is tired. And it's about the sixth hour, and I'm sure it was hot. The rest of his folks that he was with, the disciples, had went into town to buy some meat. And Jesus needed to meet someone here for some unfinished business. There was a divine appointment getting ready to be made. How many of y'all have ever made a divine appointment before and been in an appointment that you knew was of God, and there was a meeting from someone or by God or by the Holy Spirit, and you knew that that had to have been of God? Jesus here showing that he was weary in his journey. How many people's in a journey right now? Oh, I hope that y'all wake up long enough to hear just a little bit of preaching this morning. I don't know about you, but sometimes I get a little weary in my journey. Now, I'm not in the least bit complaining, nor do you hear any negativity in my voice at all. But sometimes it is what it is. This journey, we just get weary. Jeff, we get dealt hands that we didn't ask for. We get placed in situations that we certainly, by our choice, would not be. And we get tired for just doing good stuff. Jesus lived in a fleshly body. God lived in a fleshly body, and he was tired in his journey. He was tired in ministering. And no doubt that he had that old package of clay that he had to work through, and he was tired. That led me to a verse of scripture, and I'm going to read one verse. You don't have to go there. It's Galatians 6 and 9. And let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. Jesus, no doubt, was everywhere he went and every bit of energy he gave, everything he done was for well-doing. It was for the good of the people that was around him. He was very selfless. He didn't mind about his own needs, but he cared about other people's needs. And he got tired. Amen. I really don't have any time to get tired. I don't know about you. But we read here in Galatians, it says, and let us not be weary in well-doing. And the next part of the verse is very, very interesting. It says, for in due season we shall reap. Sometimes we get very busy in something that we would like to happen right away. We get very busy, Phil, in seasons of our life that we want to see accomplishment now. We want to arrive to the destination immediately. We work real hard. We do everything that God calls us to do, and we expect it to happen overnight, do we not? We read here in this verse that there are due seasons. In other words, there are seasons, and he begins to use a story about agriculture. He starts talking about sowing and reaping. And he says, in due season you shall reap. So don't get tired. Your season has not gotten here yet. Sometimes people want to reap the corn before it comes out of the ground. We put a seed in the ground, and then the little sprouting comes up, and we want to come and we want corn right away. Well, we have to understand that there are seasons that will develop the corn, and we have to have a process before the corn gets here. In due season, there will be a corn. How many folk like some good corn on the cob? We used to raise a good-sized garden at one point in time, and I like sweet corn. How many folk like white sweet corn? How many people like the yellow sweet corn? I kind of like both of it. So I heard that if you put the seed corn, white and yellow seed corn, in a bag and shake it all up and plant it together, guess what you get? You get a mix in your corn. You get white corn and you get yellow corn when you mix the seed together. That way you get both. But anyway, we sow that corn, and there's a lot of... Is anybody with me today? Is there anybody... You put that corn in the ground, and there's a lot of preparation before you put the seeds in the ground. And you dig a little hole about every 9 inches, and you put 2 or 3 kernels, seeds, in each little hole and cover it over. Has anybody ever planted corn before? Now, you fertilize the ground, you fix the ground, and you put those little seeds in the ground, and before too long, you get a little plant that comes up in no time about that time, but it's a springtime season. In due season, you're going to be able to reap this, but it's not quite ready yet. It takes time. Sometimes you get frustrated. Sometimes people get frustrated when things don't happen suddenly and don't go the way that we think that they should go right away. When God's saying, you're only in the springtime of your season and you can't reap yet because it's not harvest time for you. You will reap in your due season. That comes up a little bit. And then the next thing you know, there's some little vines begin to come up and there's little weeds come up. And the ground gets hard and dry, and you got to cultivate that ground a little bit. So you go between the rows, in a lot of cases, Donnie, with a rototiller. Anybody ever run a rototiller? Some of these ladies, older folks run a rototiller. If you are under the age of 23 and you run a rototiller, let me see. How many under the age of 23 know what a rototiller is? Listen, we come Back where I come from, a lot of times you got to raise your food. And it was awful good. Most folk today just go down to the food line and go through the produce section and buy their food. There's no due season. Don't understand what seasons are. So you run a rotor tiller. That thing beats you to death. The ground's hard. It's dry. There hadn't been any rain. And all you hope, I hope somebody's listening to what I'm saying. There's not been any rain and the weeds trying to choke at your harvest. And you just wish that the reaping season would come. But you're not quite there yet. There's a little bit of work before you can reap. Is somebody understanding what that is? I don't get thrown off by the dry season. I don't get thrown off by those seasons because I know, listen, my eye is upon the due season. I'm looking through the now seasons, through the drought in the summertime, through all the work in the springtime, and I'm looking toward latter summer, early fall, when I'm eating corn on the cob with them green beans and them taters. Amen. How many like some green beans and taters in the house? Amen. There's a season when that corn's going to come, and you'll go through there and pluck the ears, and you're going to reap that which you've harvested. And you're going to reap it, harvest it, and eat it, but you're not there yet. And what it's saying is don't be weary in your seasons. Get into the new season. I promise you, if you faint not, you will experience due season. And it's due season what keeps me going. Due season what gets me up in the morning. Due season what get me to get that hoe even though I got blisters on my hand. Due season is what get me to break up the clods of dirt. Due season what calls me to carry the water myself when things are dry and it's not rained for a while. And I'm going to hunt that water source. I'm going to tap into some water. Amen. I'm not going to put up with the dry ground. I'm going to dip her at the spring. Amen. And bring her up and begin to water my corn. Even if I'm not to carry the water myself, I'm going to do some watering in the dry season so that I can reap in the due season. Don't be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap. Now here comes that two-letter word that changes everything. If we faint not. Amen. Family is struggling today. I would venture to say that in the little church that we're at, and I know folk, I love a little church, and I love a church that grows, and I'm going to love a larger church, and I'm going to love a big church with a little church feel. You understand what I'm saying? Because we're still going to be family. There's going to be a whole lot more of us, but I love family, and I know families. Listen, I know people. I know my sheep. I know sheep. I know family. An apostle is one that's called to a certain area at a certain time, and he knows his people. That's what he does. He knows his people. And I know that there's folks struggling. I know that there's folks can't make ends meet. And I know that there's folks that sometimes don't know how it's going to get done. I know that beyond a shadow of a doubt. I know that. But if you'll just continue, you'll not faint. You'll not faint. You'll keep on keeping on. That there's going to be a reaping and there's going to be a harvest. It's not always going to be tough like it is right now. In due season, that corn gets a little taller. You ever drive around and it hadn't rained in a long time and that corn, say, may be this tall and you know it's struggling. And the blades of corn come up before too long, they begin to curl up where they hadn't been rained on. Am I the only one catching this morning? How many of y'all want to curl up sometime where it hadn't rained in a while? And then all of a sudden you see that cloud and there's some hope because you got to make it to due season. Don't give up right now. I know that it's dry. I know that there's weeds. I know that there's vines. I know that there's not much nutrients in that ground. I know that it's a struggle sometimes, but don't give up, because you will reap your harvest. And before too long, yes, brothers and sisters, we will eat sweet corn. Can I get a big hand? As we have therefore opportunity, let us do good unto all men, especially unto those that are of the household of faith. You know who that is? Look around and see all the beautiful people that surround it, that you are surrounded with. Are they not beautiful? Look around. Seriously, take a look around and look who you are blessed with. There's miracles. You're looking at miracles. You're looking at God's handiwork. You're looking at people that are absolutely amazing. I feel blessed and honored, but yes, sometimes even unworthy to be surrounded by the people that God surrounds me with. Amen. Glory to God. We should take care of those of the household of faith. Praise the Lord. Now, so Jesus was weary because it was the sixth hour, and he was wearied in his journey. Don't get weary in your journey. There cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus saith unto her, give me to drink. There comes a lady, no doubt Jesus himself is thirsty. She's thirsty. And there's a divine appointment being made right here. And there begins to be some dialogue between Jesus and this lady. And the first thing he says is, give me something to drink. For the disciples were going away into the city to buy meat. Then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, how is it that thou, being a Jew, askest of me, which are a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. There's so many different places you could go there. If people could just get together, imagine what would happen. If we would look at the ways that we are similar, what's similar is the blood of Jesus Christ applied to our hearts. And now it's the fill-in-the-blank denomination have no dealings with you can fill-in-the-blank on the other denomination. This church has no dealings with that church. This one has no dealing with that. If we could get together, that's what I love about this week, because folk get together from all over the place. We've got people from our sister church at PCC getting ready to allow us to have chairs and tables, and no doubt Pastor Chad, anything at our disposal. Wonderful folks over there. We got people from the mission church around the corner getting ready to bring some choir folk where we can hear some amazing singing, and bring a dance team of 40 to 60 people that we're going to see this week. We've got people from Roosevelt. We got people from all over the place, Virginia, coming, because we should have some dealings one with another if we're ever going to see God accomplished. Well, you know, those folk do something crazy. That person, I can't understand. This person just aggravates me. How many folks got somebody just aggravates you? Well, I got news for you. God made them the way they are, and God likes them, and God appreciates them. God put that in them, so you ought to appreciate it too. Is that all right? There's some stuff about me that aggravates y'all to death. What are some of them? Let's take the opportunity here to figure this out. You want to go? You know what? There are some things about people sometimes just. And then you got to say, God made them that way. And God even uses them in ways that we don't understand to do things and accomplish things and reach people that we just can't even get because of their quirkiness and their issues and all of this stuff. God made me this way. Amen? It's not my fault. I wish y'all folks would loosen up just a little bit. Just loosen up a little bit. Stand to your feet, everybody. Turn to your neighbor and slap him a high five. Lord have mercy, y'all can't even smack high fives. That's not a high five. Let me show you high five. That's a high five. Come on, folks, get with it. Stretch out, do something to wake up. Okay, sit down. We can't even get a high five going on in here. We're weary and well-doing, aren't we? Okay, so we've got this divine appointment. These two shouldn't even be hanging out together, much less getting water for each other. And they begin to have a conversation. Then the woman of Samaria said unto him, how is it that thou, being a Jew, asketh drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealing with the Samaritans. Jesus answered and said unto her, if thou knowest the gift of God, and who it is that saith to thee, give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. If you knew exactly what I was offering you, and you knew exactly who you were talking to, you would take advantage of this. Amen. Sometimes Jesus is right in the middle of the house, right in the middle of what you're doing. He's all in your business. He's all around, but yet you can't even recognize the handiwork of God. Jesus was all over this. He was right standing with this woman. She had no idea and didn't even recognize what Jesus was doing. Didn't even recognize the blessing, the blessedness of Jesus Christ being right in her midst. The woman saith unto him, sir, thou hast nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. From whence thou hast the living water? Where do you get this living water? You don't even have anything to get it with. And you're talking about water? You have no pail. It's deep. Amen. She began to make excuse. Jesus offers us opportunity after opportunity after opportunity and calls us into a calling and puts things and people in our lives, and we begin to make excuse. It's too deep. It's too hot. It's too long. I've got this. Don't have no time. Ain't got the money. I'd rather do something else. I'd rather do something else. Well, I've got news for you. There's nothing else I'd rather do than exactly what I'm doing right now. Amen. We've got such a wonderful group of people that's working so hard. Miss Kathy Keith and Miss Amy went grocery shopping and spent $600 on groceries yesterday. Right. It's not for y'all. Settle down, fellas. Actually, it is. But we want to feed our staff that are be here working so hard this week. We are still raising monies for Enlightened Kingsport, and we still have sponsorship letters here. We certainly by any means have not met our budget, and so if you still want to make an opportunity, we still need about everything. We could use anything that you could possibly, money-wise or food-wise or anything. We certainly are still in the process of raising monies for that event. We appreciate all the help that's been given and all that will be given. Are thou not greater than our father Jacob, which gave us this well and drank thereof himself and his children and his cattle? Jesus answered and said, whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again, but whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst, but the water that I shall give shall be in him a well of water springing into everlasting life. You ever notice things that you drink of this world just don't satisfy you, or they satisfy you for a season and then the satisfaction seems to go away? You drink water and you will be thirsty again before too long. You eat a big meal and before too long you'll be hungry again. You satisfy the lust of your flesh and before too long that appetite is still there. And you need to fill it again. And what we try to do is we try to go on a diet. And what we need to do is change your appetite. Make your appetite for something else. Amen. Now, lady, there's some water. If you'll pay attention to me, I'm trying to explain to you some spiritual things. I can give you some water that you'll not thirst anymore. Amen. You do something to satisfy this flesh, and before too long, you have to do it again and again The gentleman come up to me, he wanted an altar service. He goes, Eric, I am tired of being on this treadmill over and over and over and over and over. Well, get yourself some living water and you'll not thirst anymore and you can get off your treadmill. We're going to hurry through this. The woman saith to him, Sir, give me that water that I thirst not, neither come hither to draw. You know what? I'm tired of going to this well, and it's really weary. I have to come here every day because all of my husbands get thirsty. And I've got to come here and I've got to draw water. I would love to have me some water where nobody will get thirsty and I don't have to do this anymore. See, she's still thinking on the fleshly nature. About time that we get off of our fleshly plane and begin to reach a higher plane. And the Holy Ghost will begin to operate in him. Amen. And begin to think of what God wants to do in your life. Quit being self-centered on what you want and find out what God wants. Give me some of this water so that I don't have to come here and reach down in this deep well anymore and draw. Go call your husband and let him come hither. You know, she's not getting it. She's not understanding what Jesus is trying to say. And sometimes we don't always get it the first time. How many need to be shown more than once? Amen. Go get your husband, lady. The lady begins to tell this, she has no husband. Jesus said, For thou hast had five husbands, and he whom you're with now is not your husband. That saith truly. The woman said unto him, Sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet. You think? Now, how many folks ever had prophecy told to them before? In the modern day prophecy that we use, or we see, I shouldn't say we use, we see a whole lot. It's all good, feel good stuff. This is going to happen, and it's all good, and this and that in it. That's the way we like it. Jesus was having to tell her the truth of her life. Brothers and sisters, sometimes the truth of our life, if it being revealed, is not always pleasant and it's not always good. The woman saith to him, Sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet. Our fathers worshipped in Jerusalem and in a place where you ought to worship. Jesus said unto her, Woman, believe me, the hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor yet in Jerusalem worship the Father. Ye worship, ye know not what. What know we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour cometh, and now, is when true worshipers shall worship the Father in the Spirit and in truth, for the Father seeketh such to worship him. God is a Spirit, and they must worship him in spirit and in truth. He's trying to explain to her true worship, true living water. The woman said unto him, I know that Messiah cometh, which is called Christ. When he is come, he will tell us all things. Sometimes what you need, what God has for you, is right in front of you. And you're waiting for it to get here, and all along it's been right in front of you. And because it may not be what you expect, or it may not be in the form of what you desire, or what you think that you want, you think that it's not of God. Woman says, I know that he's going to come. We're all looking for him, and he's like, oh, are you serious, lady? You're not getting this yet? Are you serious? I'm right here in front of you. Don't quit. Don't continue to try to look for it when it's right in front of you. I'm right here. Thank you. convinces this lady of who he is, changes her life forever. And what this lady